Assalamu alaikum. I welcome all of you to this very pleasant morning in Lahore, especially the delegates who have come from outside the country and as well from outside the city. It's really a very, very pleasant morning in Lahore, and I am really privileged that very senior members of the surgical faculties, they are sitting over here. My teachers, my friends, my colleagues. And one name to mention, Professor Sanula, who taught me in third year, fourth year, and final year. I'm privileged and I'm very proud to present this paper in front of you. And I'm really humbled that my college time teacher is sitting here, and to all of my friends. I'm going to talk about the importance of team approach in surgery. We have a few short stories, a few videos, and maybe a cartoon in this presentation. So let me begin with a short story. I'm going to talk about two personalities. I'm going to present a picture. You must be familiar with this gentleman. He was the Sultan of Mysore, Tipu Sultan. He was known to be a very courageous man who would fight with the tigers with their hands. A man of undoubted chivalry and bravery, but chose to fight with the British with a team of incompetent and unwilling commanders of his army, and the result was that he lost his life and he lost his kingdom. On the other hand, a leader from a recent era, whom you know very well, Imran Khan, he was not at the peak of his career, but he was shrewd enough to collect a team of very talented young people around him. He actually noted their core competencies, gelled them into a team, and he would tell them every day that this is your goal. You are going to take this World Cup back to Pakistan. And the result was that he was able to lift this World Cup for us. So, two leaders, but with different teams and different outcomes. And in both the instances, the opponents were the British. So the moral of the story is that the person with the better team will always win. So this was the historical component of that. Doctors, I must admit, they are poor team players. Now, why I'm giving this statement, this actually comes from my own personal experience. As doctors, when we grow up, in our classes, in our batches, we would always compete with each other. There's severe competition with each other. We would hide things. We would not let other people know that how much we have studied and for how long we have studied. Chupate ek dusre se. Aadat hoti. Competitors hote hain, toppers hote hain apni classes ke. Here, then they actually get into a severe competition at the matriculation and the FSC and the A-levels, and they enter a tough competition going to the medical college. They compete with each other for positions and, you know, slots in the postgraduate training. And then finally, when they become consultants, they compete with each other for top jobs in the medical institutions. And then they enter into this ferocious financial competition when they enter into private practice. So we are all individual, ferocious players. Hum bane is tarah hain, hum taiyar is tarike se hue hain. Hum ise khai hi gaye hain. So we're not, as a community, we're not good team players. And surgery is no different from this. In surgery, individualism was the hallmark. The surgeon was responsible for his actions and was responsible for his or her, you know, patient care. My own personal experience, we had professors who were larger than life figures. They would carry an aura of strength and invincibility around them. And we never dared to ask questions from them. And they never bothered to consult us. An order was an order. We had just simply had to wait it. But things are changing. The team approach has proven that if you have to have a better surgical outcome, a better patient care, you need a good team. And there's mounting evidence for that. You can see that the evidence is there. The evidence suggests that better surgical teams would end up with good operative results and good amount of, you know, post-operative outcome for these people. But at the same time, there's also mounting evidence that teams who are not very well trained, they will have a lot of errors in their management, and the result would be a poor patient outcome. So there is a statistical evidence present for that. So what is required? Actually, this is a very common knowledge that teams are required, but we have not been able to actually put this common knowledge into a day-to-day practice in on not a very, you know, standardized way. Like other high-risk industries, like the aviation industry, has actually put this team effort into practice. And knowing that it is important, and knowing that the surgeons are actually expected to perform at a very high standard, but still we have been never taught how to actually select a team, build up a team, maintain a team, and actually assess or monitor your team. So we are going to talk about a team. So let me define that, what is a team? The technical definition for a team is that this is a group of individuals who come from diverse backgrounds and diverse trainings and diverse kind of experience. They work together in an identified unit and they work as a team for the better outcome. This is the technical definition which is present on the net. Now, what has been the structure of our teams, the surgical teams? The first model was the hierarchical model. But this model was there for centuries. Nothing wrong with this model. This was the traditional model. And there was a clear team leader. And the rest of the people had to obey him or her. Whoever was the team leader. Once again, those larger than life figures, those professors, jinse baat karna bada mushkil tha aur jinse jawab dena mushkil tha. Communication bhi bahut zabardast nahi tha aapas mein. So that was a traditional model, और ये model ऐसा नहीं कि काम नहीं था करता, ये काम करता था और ठीक ठाक काम करता था. But कुछ उसमें drawbacks थे, जिसका मैं थोड़ी बात जिक्र करूँगा. And the other is the collaborative structure. Here you have a joint communication and decision making process. This is a true collaborative practice where the hierarchical system, the leader system, is at the back. The leader is there, but in fact, the leader is not a leader, he or she is a manager. And there's a shared planning, the whole negotiation and decision-making process which is going on. So I'm going to talk about the collaborative structure today and how actually I practice this collaborative structure. Now, usually people will ask me that, how do you make a team? The question is very well taken, a wonderful question, but very difficult to implement. Teams would not come in flashes. Good team members come in a very long time. You have to make a lot of effort to build up your team. But three things are important: the team selection, team building, and the team training. I'm going to address them one by one. But you know, you have to have the right people with you. You have to have a common goal for those people to build up the team. And finally, you have to devise ways to improve the skills of your team so that the collective goal is achieved. So that is what is required. Once again, team selection. Once again, a very difficult question to answer. But, you know, my first priority would be that I would always like to take up motivated people. People who are motivated to bring in a change. So how do I, you know, accomplish this? I start my selection process from the 30. I have 30 students which I mark them. I ask them that, you know, would you like to become surgeons? Counsel them, coach them in the fourth year. Give them an opportunity in the final year to actually assist me, come in the operative theaters and, you know, join the team. And when housework ka time aata, Omar yahan baithe hain, mere senior registrar, jab ye registrar the, the team is sent to the doctor's hostel. Wahan bhi ladkon ko aur ladkiyon ko counsel karte hain to become house officers in surgical unit 2. They're sitting there, that is what I do. And they're counseled to come into the surgical 2. Usme se kuch log aa jaate hain surgical 2 mein aur wahan pe aake to kaam karna shuru karte hain. I give them a full, you know, attention, and I ask them to become surgeons. Usme se kuch log surgery mein final department mein kar dete hain, and then that is the time where I induct them after an interview process. So this is a long process. My professor, my associate professors, my assistant professor, my senior registrars, my registrars, they all come through the same process. There's no lateral entry. I strongly stop lateral entries. I want them to progress in the team. So uska fayda ye hota hai ki the team is well acquainted with each other, well gelled together. So that is my process. Right or wrong, but this is how I make a team. Now, these are the qualities I prize the most: hardworking, honest, and loyal. I'm not looking at very flashy, flamboyant, very brilliant and intelligent people. I am just looking for these three qualities. And these qualities have a background. There's a background check on them. What would this? So if a 30 student is following you right after your residency program, he's a very, very loyal student. So it is checked. And I would really like to have a team with diverse knowledge and skills. Would welcome people who can do an ultrasound in my ward. We have ultrasound facilities. Would welcome people who can do endoscopies. I have got endoscopic facilities in my ward. Would welcome people who are very good at computer and internet. So the diverse skills are utilized for achieving a common goal. So when I go to the team building process, there's a task design, I assign roles, I make sure that they are committed to their roles, the leader is there, we do communicate, we participate, and I encourage them to perform, present, and publish. Now, the task design. I would always give them a goal. The goal has to be there. If you see this picture, the picture of my residents, they're looking towards a common goal. They might be looking from different angles. They have their own perspectives, their own agenda. But the common goal is there. They have to follow that common goal. I give them a purpose, and then I make sure that each one of them knows what is the common purpose. It's very important. And then a role assignment is there. But before I assign roles, I usually would like to identify the core competencies in my residents. Some of the residents are very good at the surgical skills. Some of them, they are very good at organization. Some of them, they have got remarkable skills as far as the computer internet is concerned. Some are research oriented, and some are very good at photography and editing. I utilize each one of them. I utilize everybody's talent. And everybody's talent, and I make sure that they know that they have got individual core competencies. But their competencies are interrelated. They have to actually share their competencies. Until unless they share their competencies, they are not going to be able to achieve this common goal. So it's very important to make them understand that the role assignment is there, but the common goal has to be achieved. They have to be committed to their roles. Commitment is checked very easily by just seeing that, does the resident shun his or her responsibilities? Is he or she very particular about their timings? Are they committed to the welfare of the unit, welfare of the patient? Because the common benefit is going to get more directly to the patients ultimately. So the commitment is checked. Now, the leader. It is not important that you are the leader. You appoint one of your senior registrars the leader. Assemble two or three teams. Make sure that your leader is a sharp person. It's called a shark kehte. These are the people who are going to question you, question your skills, and they make you sharp as well, because they give you a constant, persistent competition. So you have to be, you know, up to the mark. If you are a good manager, you have to be up to the mark. So it's very important that, it is not important that, you know, you should be the leader. You can appoint leaders and ask them to actually go ahead and, you know, manage the teams. But one thing is for sure, that whoever is appointed as a leader is well beyond the rest of the team as far as knowledge and skills is concerned. In our profession, the authority, the moral authority, does not come from your age or from your position. It is your ability to teach people. When people come to you, they're not interested, they're not bothered what you know, what is your skill. They're only interested in one thing, what you can teach them. So if you can teach them, if you can give them knowledge, if you can give them skills, then you're an automatic choice. You have all the moral authority on your team, and you can do that. So it's very important that you select the leader. Communication is the core of the team. Make sure that you do communicate with each other very frequently. Have bonding meetings, have seminars, have presentations in your ward, where you get an opportunity to sit down with the team and meet the team. Let the team what you think about the team, and allow the team to express their opinions about you. So it's very important that you do communicate. And sometimes if you identify that some person is not able to achieve a certain perspective, and he or she is not putting an effort towards a common goal, then you can counsel that particular individual, so that once again he or she is diverted towards your common goal. And the common goal is the betterment of a patient who is admitted in the surgical ward. Give them a sense of participation. This is a short video. I'll just demonstrate to you that it is important to make them participate. When you initiate an operative procedure, like in the operation theater, you actually initiate a process, give them the guideline that what you want. Make sure that your second team leaders are actively involved in this process. You would operate, but you will give an opportunity to your junior team members to be in the operation and give them an opportunity to operate in front of you. Keep on counseling them, stand on one side, just see what they are doing. And do not forget the junior most member, even if he or she is a house officer. Ask them to come and use the cautery, tie a blood vessel. They will get a great sense of participation. And make sure that you do not forget your nurses and your paramedic staff. They are an important component of your team. So make sure that the participatory effort is there. Aap ye karke dekhen, aap dekhenge ke how much effort your residents would put in for the welfare of your patient. Ultimately, aapka mareez theek hoke ja raha hai, to benefit to sara aap hi ka hai. Aap hi ko sara benefit milega. Lekin, give them opportunity to participate. They will participate. One important aspect, encourage them to perform, present and publish. What I would do is that I would encourage meetings, take them to breakfasts, lunches, dinners, but take that opportunity to actually coach them and counsel them. This is one of our favorite places, the McDonald's restaurant in front of Sims. You will find that the screens are there, the laptops are there. While we are offering good breakfast to our residents, at the same time, we are trying to actually teach them, counsel them, and try to actually rectify the presentations. They have their good time, but utilize this fun time of your team. This is going to build a very strong sense of comradeship with them. So make them participate in everything. And you have to make sure that they all actually participate in this. However junior the member is. And take this opportunity to train them as well. Usually whenever there is something, some material in the ward, what we would do is that we would always actually go ahead and build up this process in such a way that the presentations, the data is compiled, the presentations are made, these presentations are put forward to the junior consultants first, and then in certain meetings these presentations are rectified. I've got good team members in the form of Dr. Varish Faluka and Dr. Kamal Ishwak, who would actually correct every presentation, and then finally these presentations are. And I encourage my residents to present a lot. In the last cancer conference we had 8 presentations, and this time in this conference we have got 14 presentations. So we want to encourage our residents to present not only in the local conferences, but conferences outside the city. They travel outside the city to present themselves to Peshawar, Islamabad and Karachi, and they also present internationally, are residents have presented in Japan, they are going to present in Australia as well. So encourage a lot of participation and their presentations. Now, if you really want to achieve a certain goal, it is very important that you put in time in improving the skills of your team. Because until unless they have got requisite skills, they would not be able to actually come up to your expectations. So I would purposefully send my residents to those courses which teach the team approach, like advanced trauma life support, advanced cardiac life support. The different kind of courses that are there. We send them to ATLS, ACLS, PALS, and BLS. And we do run the basic laparoscopic skills courses where actually the residents are taught hands-on. We have got this in our unit, we have got research and the skills lab, where we actually do hands-on training for our residents, and we do run these basic laparoscopic skills workshops for other residents as well, which is not limited to our own, because this collective benefit should go to the whole community. So we arrange it for everybody. So this process is an ongoing process, and very recently, even in this conference, we had this basic laparoscopic skills workshop and advanced skills workshop, and the team is there always to actually go ahead and do it. This is a separate topic, but you can actually map your teamwork skills. You see that how much cooperation is there, how much communication is there, the coordination or lack of coordination, the leadership, the participation and monitoring. This is there, but this is a separate topic. I'm not going to address it right now. A small cartoon presentation, which is self-explanatory. This is the famous story of the turtle and the rabbit. Can you hear that? If it's not playing, it really doesn't matter. We'll just wait for a while.
But please, Lord, anything which can
go on, it will be there.
That's it.
For a while, for 3 minutes, we should enjoy this. That's it.
The race, emerging as the undisputed champ, the race.
You have got the message, but I'll give you a take-home message. You should select a team, build up the team, give them a goal, identify the core competencies, train them to improve the team skills and achieve your goals. Do not aim to have a team of experts, have an expert team, as talent will win games, but teamwork will win championships. I would especially acknowledge the team of my surgical unit too, who actually was there to help me out in this presentation, Professor Fula Chaudhary, Professor Abdul Majeed Chaudhary. रात 12 बजे तक वो मुझे मुख्तलिफ किस्म की प्रेजेंटेशन भेज रहे थे कि आज इसको भी देख लो, इसको भी देख लो. प्रोफेसर खालिद मसूद गोल्डन, कल दोपहर को मेरे को तंग कर रहा था कि आप मुझे अपनी प्रेजेंटेशन से कुछ स्लाइड्स भेजें. आमिर जमान को भी मैंने काफ़ी तंग किया कि मुझे स्लाइड भेजे, तो अपनी प्रिपरेशन कर रहे थे, मैंने मुझे स्लाइड चाहिए. कामा खालिद खाजा हैज़ बीन हेल्पिंग मी फॉर द लास्ट टू वीक्स. इन्होंने मुझे मेरे को 16 मुख्तलिफ आर्टिकल्स भेजे अबाउट टीम कॉम्पिटेंसेज, तो इनको मैंने पढ़ा. And obviously, Professor Terim Fatima is sitting here, my wife, and I acknowledge her contribution towards this team building. And thank you very much.